Over the last two decades, museums, including ethnographic and world cultures museums, have been conscripted, been included, been questioned. International and transnational debates around questions of citizenship and belonging. But as museums that were originally framed as a space to think critically, to represent, well, to think, to represent in sometimes reductive ways about those others to Europe or to the European, what does it mean that these museums are being asked to relate to citizens, to be there for citizens? And who are the citizens of whom we speak? Who is the European that the museum is to speak to? These museums themselves emerged out in close relationship to, out of, and in some, many will say, to support colonial ideology. How should these museums address this colonial past? Do these museums perpetuate forms of what one scholar has called differentiated citizenship as appropriate spaces for those migrants who will always, in some of the ways we speak about them, be migrants and never full citizens? Or do they offer possibilities for us to rethink their location, the spaces, the urban landscapes they occupy? I've always said it has always fascinated me, not in very complex ways, it should be more complex, that ethnographic museums often seem to me anyway as the kind of multicultural, multi-historical polity that the urban cities are. Because before Amsterdam, Paris, London became multicultural, if one can call it that, these museums had diasporic objects from across the world in contested ways. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Wayne Modest, and I'm head of the Research Center for Material Culture for the Tropo Museum, Africa Museum, and the Museum Volkerkunde. Welcome to Museum Volkerkunde. Over the next 2 days, we are going to be engaging in a set of conversations not necessarily about the future of the ethnographic museums, a discussion which is probably still urgent, but one which I think we can also not set aside, but set aside a little to talk about their present and what is happening in their present, and to accept the fact that we are structuring possible futures in conversations like this. We have brought together people from all across the world in this conversation. And one of the good things about this morning is that we've invited, or the 2 days, is that we've invited speakers from very different perspectives, working within the museum and outside the museum. People from different political locations, from Israel to Canada, from Canada to France, from France to Belgium, to try and think through what it means, what these museums can mean similarly and differently within these locations. I will speak more about this later, but I wanted to just welcome you and welcome the partners of Switch, which Stephen will speak about what Switch is and explain why we're here today. And but I just wanted to say welcome this morning. Engage in conversation, engage in discussion. It is always wonderful to see a full house, even though the front rows are always empty. So for every speaker that comes up, all right, Steve occupies the front row. For every speaker that comes up, I would like them to remain in the front. And what I'd like to beg you is that while we are organized in such a fixed way, in me up here and you down there, I want this to be a conversation. Please, a dialogue. Interrupt, ask questions in respectful ways, of course, that we can lead to some kind of change in how we think together over the next couple of days.
I'll take you on the journey that we traveled when merging three ethnographic museums in the Netherlands. The Museum Volkerkunde, where you are now, the Tropen Museum in Amsterdam, and the Africa Museum in the province. And we merged in 2014. You see me here with the Minister for Culture drinking champagne. We merged three museums into one. I always emphasize that we're not three museums that have one back office. We now are one museum with three venues. We fully integrated all departments. We claim ourselves to be a national institute, so we have national ambitions. We want to raise the quality of the organization, out of which also emerged the Research Center for Material Culture, which organizes this event. We have more quality for less money, and that's all great. And now what? We said to one another 2 years ago. Why? Why have a National Museum for World Cultures? What's its purpose? Why is it here? And it's a relevant question, considering that all three museums that merged were at one point in recent time sort of suggested to be closed. Apparently, there was a sort of a tendency that we could do without these museums. So we questioned ourselves immediately after the merger, why? Why are we here? Why are we important? What's our mission? Basically, that's the question. What is our mission? And of course, one could easily then turn towards the ICOM type of definitions. We have to safeguard heritage. We have 375,000 objects, almost a million photography. That's purpose enough. But we were not content with only that. We felt, talking about it, that we should go beyond that. Our collections tell us, this is a photograph of our collection, a lot about questions of identity. We relate to diversity. Very often politicians put us in that place. You are about diversity. It's a very politicized idea. Cultural dynamism is all over our collections. Exchange, trade, migration, it's in our collections. As well as the colonial histories and slavery, matters like that. They're all connected to our collections. So first we tried to find a mission that encompasses all these words, all these themes. And that would probably have resulted in like 500 words, 7 sentences as a mission statement that nobody actually would ever remember apart from the marketing department that has to write it up all the time. Most of these mission statements actually are not very well implemented in any company all over the world. If you ask people working there, what's the mission, the purpose of your organization, many people don't really know. And we needed a mission that would guide us, that would lead us in our development, shortly after that merger. So we felt we needed a very simple theme, a theme that would enable us to put into practice these themes, that would enable us to dialogue, to have this internal dialogue among ourselves. What does it actually mean to talk about migration in relation to our collections and our society? So we invented this mission, to inspire world citizenship. And of course, many of you would say that is a questionable mission, because what does it actually mean? It could be it's very vague if you don't explain what world citizenship means. Actually, we didn't really try to define what world citizenship means for us. We don't need a definition of what we are or what we are doing. We need a focus point of where we are more or less going. And world citizenship implies responsibility, implies societal relevance, implies an open mind towards the world. And that's the sort of things that we want to inspire in our audiences and in our visitors. Having said all this, we realized that this term could also be seen as somewhat patronizing. This museum is only welcoming people that embrace globalism or that read newspapers. And of course, we don't want to be patronizing. The Dutch have a history of being rather patronizing. So especially our museum doesn't want to be patronizing. So we then started to think of a translation of the mission that we could put on the wall, literally, that we could communicate to our visitors. And that resulted in the idea of becoming a museum about people. And this is a sort of a manifesto that we literally give to stakeholders. It's in Dutch. I didn't translate it for this situation, but it's in Dutch, and it says, our objects, our collections, tell you that we share in the world human emotions, that we all live, that we are humans, we share humanity, we share a world. We are people, and that's what this collection basically is about. A museum about people. So this is our the position we took in the Dutch museum world. Now, what does that mean? What does it mean that we are now a museum about people? Well, it has many consequences. For instance, our exhibition policies are based on this idea. So this is a picture of a museum, an exhibition about body art. All over the world, we do something with our work, our body. We change it, we sometimes, how do you say it in English? Well, we make art with our bodies, and we do it for certain reasons. We want to express, we want to be part of groups, we want to make a statement. So instead of going regional, we go thematic. It doesn't mean that we can never do things that are iconic or regional. This, for instance, is an exhibition about the Hajj, which is a worldwide phenomenon. It is, in that sense, in a certain sense, also regional, because it's taking place in Mecca. The exhibition was called Longing for Mecca. We still can do regional cultural things, but we always want to relate it to the world, to a broader perspective. We also show in which way the world is connected. This idea of world citizenship, this is an exhibition about the 60s. And there we emphasize how in the 60s the world got open, how influences from all over the world traveled, and how fashion design, for instance, you can see there the Queen Beatrix wearing a Moroccan dress. It all happened in the 60s. So the way we approach exhibitions is changing. We always question now, is it about the world and is it about people? And many subjects that may have been developed into an exhibition in previous years no longer survives this checklist. Our marketing is changing too for the exhibitions. As you can see, no longer objects on our posters, but people. People first. It's the objects they make, but it's the people that we find the most interesting. Our corporate communication puts people central. And also our collection policies have been redefined. We're looking now, we've redefined five focus areas in which we now want to collect. We can always collect the classic ethnographic object, but we also now are looking specifically for contemporary art, for pop culture, for fashion, for design, and for photography. Because these are areas in which this idea of an interconnected, dynamic world of people exchanging is very well expressed. And it makes it more contemporary, more relevant for today. Of course, education is central in the concept of world citizenship. The world citizen of the future is born today. So we emphasize youth and education. And diversity, world citizenship, literally in staff, is becoming very important too. We are still rather white and rather Western oriented. So we really have to make a difference, which is actually not very easy, but we commit to that. We also acknowledge the fact that we can reach this not only by making exhibitions. A museum should be and is much more than just show and collection. So we have a whole range of activities outside or aside of the exhibitions that deal with in co-creation, very often developed in co-creation, that deal with all kinds of aspects, like also gender, like, for instance, hair as a sort of an expression of identity. Next week we will have, or in 2 weeks' time, we will have an event about hip-hop. Is that collection, yes or no? It's the type of activities we think that relate to this idea of a changing world where we as a museum want to be part of the debate. And so that's the road that we traveled. One could say, maybe it's too soon, but it pays off. Visitor numbers are in the rise. We feel that we, with this more human-oriented approach, are more accessible to our publics. And we try to really move away from the old-fashioned idea of ethnographic museums as being rather historically oriented, object-oriented, problematic in many ways. Maybe even, you know, people think that these collections shouldn't be here. If we stay in that arena, the future of our organizations would be in peril, and we would be meeting every other 2 years to discuss the future of ethnographic museums. The future of ethnographic museums, actually, we think, is in doing things like this, is in actually practicing what we preach instead of talking about it. And as a sort of a uitsmijter, as you say it in English, as sort of a closing, I want to show a little film of one of the events, the Good Hair Festival, that gives a sort of a feeling of what we try to strive for as a museum.
Op mijn afro.
Ik heb heel lang een gewone afro gehad. En nu recentelijk is dit een soort van moderne interpretatie ervan.
Stijl.
Waarom is roze haren?
Waarom paars? Oh ja, ik hou gewoon van anders.
Lange tijd van dat ik me een beetje schaamde voor mijn haar. En dat ik nu nog steeds met een afro vind ik nog een hele stap wel.
Wat zou dat voor jou, wat zou dat jou geven dan als je nu een afro kan roken?
Vrijheid.
Just say, hey, 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 you'll be my firefly.